Greetings, this is the flashlight reviewer Selbuilt, and welcome to part of my ongoing series giving an overview and explanation of the various components and characteristics of flashlights. Today I'm going to talk a bit about beam patterns and reflectors, obviously a critical part of any flashlight. I have here in front of me, for example, a very massive large flashlight with a very large reflector. It has a couple of interesting characteristics. It's very smooth, as you can probably tell, very reflective. It's also very deep and very wide. And the point to this is that if you want to throw a flashlight beam a good distance, you need to sort of combine all the light in a way that really focuses out to where you want to go. Emitters are quite small, as you can see there, but they're not point sources of light. You really need to have a decent sized reflector coupled with even a relatively small emitter like this to combine all the light together and throw it out in the kind of pattern that you want, especially if you want a good distance. Part of the other aspect of this is a fairly deep reflector that's also required typically to pull the light together. And that also has certain other effects on the beam. Now, this is a very simplistic kind of overview. There's a lot more detailed information on the flashlight forums if you want to learn more about reflector physics. But in very simple terms, you need to have a fairly decent sized reflector, both for width and depth, to get good throw. There are exceptions to that, though, and I won't get into all those specific details. One comment I want to make right now is you can also see this reflector is at a very smooth finish. That also tends to be important for very good throw. Something else you'll come across quite often on the flashlight forums are what we call textured reflectors, or orange peel, kind of a fanciful name just referring to the pattern of stippling on the reflector. And I know it's kind of hard to see here given the light in the office, but I think you can tell it's not very smooth how it looks. This is kind of ridgy pattern or texturing all over the surface of the light. This is referred to as OP often on the flashlight forums. And this one is what I would call probably a light or medium OP. You see LOP and MOP sometimes, just to sort of differentiate the degree of texturing. The point of the texturing is to smooth out imperfections in the beam. What often happens, especially in some of the older emitters, you'd have a lot of beam rings and distortions in the beam, especially incandescent lights in the old days, because they're very much not point sources of light. So the stippling pattern helps smooth out the pattern, usually at the expense of throw. It tends to smooth out the hot spot of the beam, as well as some of the other characteristics. But overall, it can be a very helpful device if you want to have a very pretty looking beam and you're not really concerned about the maximum throw. So that's in the abstract. Let's talk about some specifics. And for this part, I'm going to dim the lights of my office here. So this will hopefully allow us to see things a little bit better. So I'm going to start with a couple of flashlights. Here's an old one that uses the old Cree XRE emitter, which is typically very good for throw. So I'll just sort of put it on here. You can see certain characteristics of a flashlight beam. The first thing I'm going to show you is you can probably tell faintly there are some rings at various points in the beam. The center part of the beam here is what we call the hot spot. So this is the main focused area of the light. Everything outside the hot spot out to the periphery here is what most people would call a spill beam. There's also the area known as the corona, which there isn't much of one in this sample, but it's the area right outside the hot spot before it kind of gets into the more even spill beam area. So those are kind of the terms people use most often. Beam rings refer to these, I know they're hard to see, but this kind of pattern of rings at various points in the beam. If you had stippled the reflector or textured it, you could have gone away from a lot of that and smoothed parts of it out, but at the expense of the center beam not being as throwy. Again, some of the other aspects you'll see, this light has a very defined hot spot. It's a very sharp edge to the beam. That is a reflection of the fact that it's a relatively deep and smooth reflector with a relatively small emitter for good throw. So that's one example of a beam pattern. Here's another older light that has a very stippled reflector, although it's hard to see, also with an XRE. And in this case, I'll put that up to max, the pattern here is a little bit different. There is less of a, hold it but to the same height, there's a more graded coming out of the hot spot, so there's a wider corona to the light as people refer to it. The other thing you'll notice is the overall spill beam pattern is not as wide. If I put the two lights up side by side at about the same height, there we go. You can see that the one on the right is a little bit wider in terms of its beam. And that again reflects the fact that if you have a very deep reflector, but a head that's not very wide, the overall spill beam width will also get a bit narrower. This is important when you want to talk about whether or not a light is throwy or floody. And I'll give you another example here. This is a light that has a relatively small reflector and an XML emitter. I'll put that on to max. So again, you can see a similar kind of pattern that I was talking about a moment ago. So there's some reflections here on the desk, maybe that'll help. You can see again, this one has an even broader hotspot. That's because it uses a larger emitter. This is, uses the newer XML emitters. And in a small head like this, that's going to give you a wider dispersion of the hotspot, so it's not going to be as pronounced. But the overall spill beam width, you can see, also seems to be brighter, the overall diameter width. So again, if I put these both on side by side, get the rough level about the same, you can see the overall pattern of these lights is quite different in the sense that the spill beam width is wider now on the one on the left. Now, this gets back to, again, if you consider a light floody. In a classic sense, the degree of floodiness of a light refers to how much of a differentiation you have between the spill and the hotspot. If it's very pronounced, as it was on this light, you'd consider that very throwy. On a light where it's more graded like this, most people would consider this kind of floody. The question becomes, what do you consider a light that's like this? And again, so, okay, it has a bit of a grid. It's not as much, you know, defined area around the hotspot, but the overall spill beam is not as wide. So most people would not consider this a floody light, even though the characteristic between the spill and the hotspot is less great than a really throwy light. The overall spill beam width also matters. Part of the challenge here, of course, is that if you can imagine the same light, if it had a wider spill, that spill would be dimmer for the same amount of light being produced. So that might make it look like the hotspot is brighter relative to the spill. So the bit about being a floody light is not something that really any two people are ever going to agree on. It's kind of dependent on the exact example of the light in front of you. Something you can do to sort of help even out beams is to use a diffuser. And there's a number of different types and brands of diffusers. They're typically just a frosted piece of glass or plastic that you put over the lens or replace the lens of the light with. And you can see this is an O-light filter. It fits onto most lights of about this size, if I can get that to sort of snap on. And you can see the effect it has on the beam here. So it now diffuses the light out. The spill becomes wider overall, but it falls off more quickly. It doesn't have a defined spill as much. And the differentiation between the hotspot and the spill almost disappears. I know you can still see some of it on the camera, but that's because of how close I have it. You know, at a further distance, it looks like a general amount of light, you know, over the area. And you can see, again, if I take it off, you know, the difference in how the pattern looks. So something like a diffuser can be a good option for people if you want to have a much wider beam with less, you know, of a defined hotspot. I personally like it, for example, taking my dog out in the backyard. I can see the whole area all at once. I'm not sort of playing, you know, follow the bouncing ball hotspot as you tend to do in this kind of defined light. So those are a couple of examples of reflector lights. That's by no means the only type of lights that you have out there. You have a variety of other types of lenses. You have aspherics. For example, this is the Dyrolite DBS, a popular light that has a very large aspherical lens. And you can see at the base of it there, it's magnifying and reflecting the emitter at the base of this sort of convex lens. The beam pattern with this is a lot more focused. In fact, it's kind of hard to see it there. I have another example of a light that's a little bit smaller. Actually, these two lights, both inexpensive little lights that use a smaller version of an aspheric head. I'll start with the stock model. This is using a little Nietzsche emitter, and you can see what it does is it produces kind of a blue-tinted beam with kind of like a spot beam, if you think of it for a second. Like, imagine yourself on a stage, and just the beam comes on. It's a very, you know, round, even beam, a bit brighter around the edging with a little bit of blue. That just happens to be the type of emitter that is being used, and it produces this kind of very defined hotspot. It's a very different type of beam. Here's the same light that I've modified with a Cree emitter. And you'll see the pattern, so I'll put them side by side, may look kind of similar at the low level. But what happens now, if I actually pull the light further and further away from the desk, you can begin to see something. You notice that Space Invader pattern? That's basically a projection of the Cree dye image. So that's what the emitter looks like up close. So you get a good chance to sort of see it. There we go. Clouds are going by, so my office is getting a bit darker. You can now see the beam pattern a little bit different. So it's kind of a cute, different pattern. Obviously, this isn't very functional for everyday life. You probably don't want to be looking at a Space Invader symbol as you go by your daily activities. But it is a way to kind of get a very focused and tight beam. So that's kind of the option of aspherics, and a lot of people go for them. You get a very tight, focused beam. Something else you can have, this is like an example, and I've got another one over here as well. You know, two surefire lights that use optics. These are different kinds of optics. You know, they're usually referred to as total internal reflection optics, TIR. The one on the left is a little bit different. You can see the emitter there fairly clearly. If we put it on, this again gives you a fairly kind of focus tight hotspot. You can see though there is still some spill around the light. It's kind of diffuse, not as well defined. As we move back, kind of move forward, you can kind of see the overall pattern. It's an interesting type of beam. Tends to be fairly well focused, but not quite as well focused as an aspheric, for example. And here's another version of it on the Invictus, which I'll just bring up here in output. Maybe dial that down a little because I don't think you need it quite that bright. Yeah, maybe keep it somewhere low on minimum level. You can see the beam here is very defined, very focused. There's not a lot of spill coming out around it, although there is some. This is a much brighter light, though, so it's a bit hard to see on the camera. But again, just another kind of way that manufacturers find to focus their lights into what they're looking for. So anyway, that kind of gives you just a bit of a brief overview into the types of lights and their various reflectors and patterns. I hope you found that useful and relevant for dissecting some of the images that I show up in my reviews. One thing I tend to do a lot of are what people derisively refer to sometimes as white wall beam shots or white wall hunting. The reason for this obviously is, in real life you don't go staring at white walls up close, but it can be very helpful for discriminating the characteristics between different lights. If I were just to sort of light up my office here, all lights would do a pretty good job of that. What really matters is you want to see the differences in the beam. So up close shots on a white wall sometimes can be very helpful to distinguish the different characteristics, how much throw, how much spill, how sharp the definition is. And from that, you can infer a lot about how the light actually works in practice. At the end of the day, most of these lights do a pretty good job for the task that we need, especially in a sort of close to intermediate distance. Where you'll see a big difference between lights is on the thrower ones for a greater distance. And for that, I do outdoor beam shots that show you at about 100 yards or so what the high output thrower lights look like. Anyway, I hope you found that overview helpful. Thanks for your time.